Hello everyone, welcome to our channel DexLab Analytics. My name is Niharika Rai and in this particular video I will be talking about a topic, hypothesis testing in statistics. If you haven't watched my previous videos, you can click on the I button on the top right hand side corner of your screen and you will be directed to the link of those videos. So without wasting any further time, let's get started. Hypothesis testing in general means that there is some old theory which is there against which you want to prove your current theory, and you want to check whether your current theory is surpassing the concepts of your old theory or not. So suppose that there is an ice cream factory which claims that 90% of the content of that ice cream is milk. Against that, you say that no, it is not true. Instead of 90% of the milk content, either the milk content is less than 90%, greater than 90%. Therefore, this is going to be your old theory, which states that the milk content in the ice cream is approximately 90% or equal to 90%, and against that your new theory states that it is not the case. Instead, it is either less than or greater than. Now we have two options in our new theory. Either you say that the milk content is greater than 90% or you say less than 90%. So you can only prove, you try to prove only one point at a time. So in statistical terms, this old theory is called null hypothesis, and this new theory is called alternative hypothesis. So the old theory says, the null hypothesis says, the system is in control, there is nothing new happening, everything is balanced or stable. Whereas the new theory, this alternative hypothesis, should say the old theory is wrong, the system is out of control, there is imbalance in the theory of the null hypothesis or something like that. So statistically or in stats, you write null hypothesis as HO, mu equals to 90%, which basically means that on an average the milk content in the ice cream is 90%. Against that, the alternative is written as less than 90%. So this is null hypothesis, this is alternative hypothesis. Null hypothesis in general is the old theory, and alternative hypothesis is your new theory. Now there is a measure to check this this theory in or assumption. Now there can be several ways to check whether this is true or not, whether null is true or alternative is true. Now for that, there can be three paths. Either you check the hypothesis, there is a reason why it is called hypothesis testing, because you are testing whether some null is true or not, or your new theory is true instead. So there are three ways to do that, or three formulas on the basis of the kind of data you have, the kind of measurement you have. In case if you are checking mean, then you have mean testing. In that also you have two parts: whether you know the standard deviation or not, when the standard deviation is known, and when standard deviation is unknown. Whether you are checking testing the hypothesis on the basis of variance, or you are checking the hypothesis based on proportion. Now, when it comes to mean, it basically means that whether you are checking a data or testing a data on the basis of averages. So we'll say the average salary of 2017 is 5 lakhs. Now you want to say that suppose that the government is saying that the salary hasn't increased. Suppose, okay, this is just a hypothetical assumption. And now you want to check against that whether in 2020 this 5 lakh average, on an average this 5 lakh has changed or not. So you say that the null says that it is equal to this, and the alternative says this should be 20. So in 2017 the average was 5 lakh. Now you want to check whether in 2020 the average is same or not. So some say that it is 5 lakh, some say it is not. So in case we are checking averages, that average salaries, then in that case we use mean testing of mean. Okay, in case we are checking differences, we are checking for differences, we use variance formula. In case we are checking for percentages, like in our previous example, 90% of the ice cream is made up of milk contents, in that case you check for proportions. The formula of each is different based on the data you are taking. So when I say that hypothesis testing of mean, I am comparing averages, or I am using average formula. When I am saying when I am checking for differences in certain samples, suppose that there is a soil, two soils or two lands which are producing some product. Now I want to check whether there is a difference in the production of sample 1 to sample 2. There is a difference or not of the production of two land. In that case I'll use variance. Otherwise, in any other cases, like in when we have percentages, then we use proportion. So the formula differs based on the kind of testing you are doing. Now in this average example, we are using equals to and not equals to sign. Okay, so this is when you're using equals to sign and not equals to sign, in that case this is called a two-tail testing. Two-tail test. Now the reason why it is called two-tail test is because you do not care whether the salary is 5 lakh. You do not care if it is greater than 5 lakh or less than 5 lakh. You care that you want to just prove that it is not equal to 5 lakh. So in that case it doesn't matter. Suppose we are drawing a graph here, which is a normally distributed graph. Okay, and suppose that there is a certain criteria on the basis of which, suppose that this is 5 lakh, okay? If it is equal to 5 lakh, the average is equal to 5 lakh, in that case you can say that that the null hypothesis is true, okay? And in any case, apart from that, since you see that in this graph, if it is less than 5 lakh, then also it is disapproving of the null hypothesis. And even if it is greater than 5 lakh, it is saying that no, the null hypothesis is wrong. So that is why it is called two-tailed test, because it is open-ended from both the sides. It can be greater or it can be less, but we have to check whether it matches 5 lakh or not. Now there is also something called left-tailed test. Left-tailed test basically means that the null is 5 lakh and you are trying to prove that the average salary is actually less than 5 lakh. So you see the tail of this less than sign is on the left side. So when you are making a graph, you actually don't care about whether it is greater than 5 lakh or not, but you actually care about less than 5 lakh. So in that case it is left tail test. When you are checking for anything lesser, in that case it is left tail test. Left tail test. Now if you are checking for greater, the tail of the greater than sign is on the right side. So you say that if average, you are checking for, no, you are saying that no, the average salary is greater than 5 lakh according to me in 2020. So the tail of this greater than sign is on the right hand side. So when you draw a graph, you see that there is only the right hand test available here. This is called right tail test. Now there are a few things which are needed to be and we need to understand in reality, that sometimes when we are testing the hypothesis, we can turn a bit biased. That means we can accept the null hypothesis. That means we can accept that the old theory is true, even when it is not in reality. So in that case, we are creating an error. So let's talk about errors in hypothesis testing. Errors in testing. For that, what we are going to do is we are going to make a basic graph, a basic table. Except null, reject null. Here we have true and here we have false. Now when we accept null hypothesis when it is true, there is no error. That means the old theory is true and we are accepting it. That means we are making no mistake. And to define that, we write it as 1 minus alpha. When we reject null, that means when we reject our old theory, even when it is true, in that case, it is called type 1 error. And it is written as alpha. Now when we accept null, when it is false, that means when we are again creating a bias, and even though we know that the old theory is wrong, we accept the null, then it is called type 2 error. Type 2 error. And it is represented by beta. And when we reject the null, when it is false, it is, then again if there is no error, and it is represented by 1 minus beta. So these are the kind of errors which might take place when we are creating a bias in our testing, where 1 minus alpha is the probability of accepting the null hypothesis when it is true, beta is the probability of accepting the hypothesis accepting the null hypothesis when it is false, alpha is the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is true, and 1 minus beta is rejecting the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false. Now suppose this type 1 error is also called level of significance, that is what is the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is true, that is rejecting the old theory when it is true. So before even starting our hypothesis testing, we beforehand assume that we might commit a type 1 error, and we take some value in extra in hand, that is we assume that we, before testing the hypothesis, we choose the level of significance by ourselves, that is suppose that there is 5% chance that we can commit type 1 error. So this is nothing but 5% probability of committing type 1 error. So we assume it beforehand and then we start our hypothesis testing, so that even though there are some errors, because of this pre-assumption, we are able to predict, or we are able to analyze or test our data perfectly by assuming that this is the chances of committing type 1 error. So I'm going to make a graph here. Generally what happens is that a normally distributed graph represents 100% of your data. Okay, suppose that take the example of that 90% Amul milk. Okay, we are saying that null hypothesis states that there is, or say 5 lakh example. The average salary is 5 lakh, okay, and we are saying that it is not 5 lakh, it is greater than that or less than that. So that means we are saying that we are performing a two-tailed test here. So what happens is, since we have taken the probability of a 5% chance that we might commit a type 1 error, we make the considerable changes or precautions before even testing already, because we have taken this 5% of significance level. So what we do is, instead of instead of saying that this 100% data will give us the correct result, we say that instead of 100% data, let's consider 95% data that gives us correct predictions or correct results. Let's remove the 5% so that the probability of committing type 1 error reduces. Okay, so now that we have 95% of the data and this is a two-tailed test, what we do is we divide this 5% into 2, since this is a two-tailed test. That means if normal curve is divided in half, 50% data is here and 50% data is here, but since now we have 95% of our data available here, we technically divide the entire graph based on 95%. So 47.5% of your results are this side and 47.5% of your results are this side. Out of that, whatever the value is on this side, we are left with 5 divided by 2, that is 2.5 and 2.5. Because this is a two-tailed test, we are dividing 5 divided by 2 because this is a normally distributed graph. So instead of 100% data, now we have 95% of our data within this acceptance region. Assuming in the beginning that old theory is true, we take 47%, we divide the graph in half, where here we might have some value closer to zero, and as we move along the scale, it was plus on this side and negative on this side. So no matter what happens, we'll get the result either on the lesser side or at the plus side or within the acceptance region. This is called acceptance region. Okay. Now, this is called rejection region. Since we have already made the necessary arrangements for not committing the type 1 error, we are left that we have completely separated 2.5% of data here and 2.5% of data here. Now what happens is that based on some formula, when we derive the result, if the value comes within these lines, I'll tell you what these lines are. Okay. Within these lines, in that case it is accepted, the null is accepted. This is nothing but 1 minus alpha, and in any other cases we have alpha divided by 2, that is 2.5. here that is in the rejection region. Now these lines or these pointers are nothing but something called a new term is critical value. So critical value is the point or the limitation which divides the acceptance region and the rejection region. Now, how do we calculate that? For that, we will need a table. Now, this is a standard normal table. I have just googled it. You can also do that. Just type in the Google, write normal distribution Z test table, and you get a table like so. And in that table, what you can do is based on what your significance level is. Based on what your significance level is, what you can do is you can calculate what your critical value should be. So here in the above second row, you see that we have 0.5 significance level, and we already know that the entire graph or the acceptance region in particular is now a 95% has a 95% ratio, and on a half of that is 47.5. So what we do is we convert it into 0.75, and then we check what is the closest value in this entire entire column to which this can be reached. So once we have once we match this, so suppose that we have 0.75 here, so we'll search which is the closest match to this particular value. So I have 744 here and not 8. We reject this part. And you see we have 744 here. 0.4744. So 4744. And if we take, if we see 0.4798, so it is higher. So as close as we can be with this particular value, we go in this table and then we match this to this value. And this is how you find your critical value. So here I have 1.9. So this 1.9 is actually my critical value here. So here what I'm going to do is I'm going to write 1.9. Okay, now I'm going to apply, since I'm trying to compare averages, I'm going to use a formula, that is x bar minus mu upon this divided by under root n, and this is basically z test formula. Now when I say z test, that basically z test basically has a property of having a large sample size, and when we know the standard deviation of our data set, then in case that we use z test, and this is hypothesis and this is the formula for hypothesis testing for mean. Now once we apply the formula and once we have the comparison of averages, suppose that in previous years we are going to apply this formula. Suppose that in previous years what happened is that our average salary was 5 lakhs. Okay, so and in the current year the average salary, the 2020, we have the average salary as 6.5 lakh. Okay, now what you're going to do is we are going to use a standard deviation of the standard deviation if provided. If we are not provided with the standard deviation, we will calculate it based on the 2020 year and divide it by number of observations or number of samples we have in our x data or current data, that is 2020. Whatever the value is, suppose that we have 2.1 here. Now what we are going to do is we are going to draw a graph. We already know that based on 5% of significance level our and two tail test, our critical value is 1.9. Now all we need to do is see that the test results, if they are falling within, if the test results are falling within this minus 1.9 and plus 1.9, then in that case we will accept the null hypothesis, and in our case, since the value, the result is 2.1, this is completely hypothetical. I have not calculated here anything. I am just giving you an example. So suppose that this, the result is 2.1. So if in any case that since we have 2.1 as a result, that falls outside 1.9, somewhere around, say here. In that case, we will reject our null hypothesis and we will say that no, the average is not the same, it has changed and it is on the higher side. That's it. So that is why we use critical values to check whether to see on which side our end result of the z statistics is coming, and then we either accept or reject based on that table. We calculate the critical value and then we accept or reject our null hypothesis based on the z statistics result and this formula. So that's that. In any case, if you do not have the standard deviation, one will use t test and the formula will remain the same. Only the difference is that instead of standard deviation, you will be calculating the sample standard deviation and then you are going to use it like that. So the formula changes. And secondly, t-test is used when the sample size is less than or equal to 30 and not more than that. Here in z statistics, the sample size can be greater. That should be greater than 30. That's that. So that's it for this video. I hope you learned something from this video. If you like this video, please click on the like button. If you haven't already, please click on the subscribe button. If you want to know more about DexLab Analytics, you can go to the website www.dexlabanalytics.com or you can call us on the number on the screen. Thank you for watching. Take care. Bye-bye.